so consumed with Jesus that the approval of others doesn't mean very much. I want you to imagine waking up every single day with this mindset that, man, I'm only here to please God. I'm living, breathing, walking this life out on earth to please God. And the approval of others doesn't even matter. You see, that's possible. Listen to me, it's not even that hard to do. I'm not talking about perfection. I'm just talking about waking up every day, living to please God, and not seeking after the approval of others. But now, here's the problem. And here's our topic for this morning. If you're looking for a label, we're going to talk about choosing purpose over popularity. Choosing purpose over popularity. Now, here's our problem. Most of us in this room, most of us, choose popularity over purpose. Not always intentionally. It's kind of a, I don't know what you'd call it, it's kind of a default mechanism that we have. We just seem to lean that way. We just bent toward the approval of others. Most of our lives are we're seeking the approval of other people. Now here's what happens. When I'm gonna make this as simple as I can. When you don't know the purpose of a thing, you misuse the thing, right? Okay, men, maybe some women out there, if you know what this is, don't say it out loud. How many people know what this is? Just a raise of hands. A few of you know what that is, okay? Some of you are like, what the heck is that, okay? So I asked the kids, here's what one of them told me this is. It's like if you had really hot coffee, or if you had like really hot chocolate, they're like, it's a cup holder. When I'm going to sell these at Starbucks starting next week. If you see these in Starbucks, you could say, that's Pastor Troy right there. He told me, it's a cup holder. For like when you have a really hot drink, it's a cup holder. Right? How many of you think this is a cup holder? It's not a cup holder. Okay, it's not a cup. Listen, when you don't know the purpose of a thing, you will misuse the thing. You will misuse the thing. Now, some of you are like, I shouldn't even tell you. This is an oil filter changer. For an automobile, okay? You put this on the oil filter, you take it off. There's different sizes. This is a really small one. Make even smaller one for motorcycles. It's an oil filter changer. It is not a cup holder. If some of you are thinking, wow, that's a great idea. It's not a cup holder. But when you don't know the purpose of a thing, you will misuse the thing, correct? Now here's what we do. Many of us don't know the purpose of our lives, so we misuse our lives. If you don't know the purpose of a thing, don't ask the thing, right? If you don't know the purpose of a thing, don't ask the thing and don't ask other things. What would you do? You would ask the one who created the thing, right? You would ask the one. Most of us don't know the purpose of our lives, but here's what we do. We don't know what our purpose in life is, so here's what we do. We ask other things what the purpose of our life is because we don't know. So we ask other people, do you like me? Do you like me? Do you think I'm cool? Do you like the way I dress? Do you like my outfit today? Do you like the way that I dressed? I wrote down all kinds of things. Do you like my house? Do you like where I live? Do you think it's cool? Do you like my car? You like the color of my car? Do you like the way I talk? Do you think I talk too fast? Some people think I talk too fast. Do you think I talk too fast? What do you think about the way I talk? Do you follow me? And do you follow me on Facebook, Instagram? I was texting you the other day, and we were talking back and forth, and I saw the bubbles, and then all of a sudden they disappeared. Do you like me? Do you like me? Do you like me? Do I fit in? Do I fit in? Am I valuable? Am I valuable? Tell me my purpose. Am I good enough? We try to find our meaning in what other people think of us, all the while missing the divine purpose that God has for us. Because we're seeking the approval of others. If you want to find out the purpose of a thing, don't ask the thing or other things. Ask the one who created the thing. Ask the one who created the thing, right? If you want to know the purpose of a thing, don't ask the thing. Ask the one who created the thing. Now, you write this down. This is not really one of our points, but you need to get this morning. Living for the approval of people will keep you from the purpose of God. Living for the approval of people will keep you from the purpose of God. Anytime we're so consumed with what other people think of us, we're going to miss what God thinks of us. And how many of you this morning would agree with me that it's more important what God thinks of us than it is what people think? then why in the world are we so stinking consumed with approving people then? Why? When we get that consumed with the approval of people, we will miss the purpose of God in each and every one of your lives. You're going to miss it. And what we end up doing is we choose popularity over purpose. Every time. Hands down. Every time. I want to show you that in a biblical story. You all know the story of Moses, correct? Some of you have seen it with Charlton Heston. You've seen the cartoon version, whatever version you've seen. Most of you know the story, so I'm not going to go that deep into the story. But you know that Moses was born a Hebrew slave. He was adopted into the house of Pharaoh. He was adopted into royalty by Pharaoh's daughter. So he lived a lavish life. He lived a life of comfort and ease. Now watch this. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 24. It says this. And this is in the Heroes of Faith, actually, Hebrews 11. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose, remember that word chose, that's a key word right there. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy, another key word, the fleeting pleasures of sin. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt because he was looking ahead to the reward. Back to verse 25. He what? Chose. Say that word with me. He did what? He chose. He chose. He chose that life. He chose. Listen, he could have chosen a life of ease. He could have chosen a life of popularity, a life of comfort, a life where he would have just been royalty. But he chose purpose over popularity. See, something was going on in Moses. He knew that there was a call of God, that there was a purpose in his life. So he made a choice to choose that purpose over popularity, over comfort. And one of the reasons why was in verse 25. It says he chose it over the fleeting pleasures of sin. The pleasures of sin, or we could put it in this way, popularity. How many of you know that popularity is fleeting all the time? It's fleeting. It is so temporary. Fulfilling your purpose in God is so eternal. It's so eternal. Popularity, man, it's how many of you know who won the World Series last year? Help me. Royals. See, I didn't know. How many of you know who won the Super Bowl last year? How many of you are like me? You're like, I know the Chargers didn't. Denver won. I know the Chargers didn't. That's all I know. How many of you know who won the NBA championship 2 years ago? The Golden State Warriors. How many of you don't care who won last year? Amen? Sorry. Listen. You can tell where I stand. Listen. You don't even remember. Popularity is so fleeting. It's so temporary. But when you're fulfilling the purpose of God, it's eternal. It's eternal. It's so important. Man, we're looking at Moses here, and he chose his purpose over popularity. He chose Moses. If you look at it, this is Moses, and it says in verse 26, you can jump to verse 26 up there. It says that he was looking ahead. Looking ahead. It's almost as if Moses is recognizing, yes, right now, for this moment, for this brief, fleeting moment, I could live in comfort. I could live in royalty. I could have it all. Or I could choose the purpose for which I was put on this earth. And fulfill God's purpose. Yes, it might be painful. Yes, it might not seem good all the time. But it will last for all eternity. It will last for all eternity. He says it this way. It may be difficult, and there may be pain. Verse 26, it says, but for the reward. But for the reward. I want to have another series. Another message in this. Choose the reward. Choose the reward. And I'm working on that kind of. Choose the reward. It was as if Moses was looking ahead to a reward, to a reward. And it wasn't about everything he could have in this moment. It was as if he's talking about this moment right here versus all of eternity. The problem is most of us, we don't spend our lives as Moses, verse 26, looking ahead. We do not spend our lives looking ahead. Because he did, he chose purpose over popularity. Now, I'm going to, I don't know what the right word is, disarm it. I don't want to say make it smaller. I want to make this word purpose not seem so intimidating, I guess would be the word. I want to tackle this word purpose and not make it so intimidating. But before I jump into that, I also want you to understand that that word purpose is really one of the key words at Ignite Church. It is one of the key words in our vision. It is one of the key things that we built this whole church around. We believe Ignite Church exists for all of you to fulfill your God-given purpose. That's our vision. That's our goal. We say this all the time. Our vision is not for all of you to help us fulfill our purpose. Our vision is for all of us to help you fulfill your purpose. Because we believe when the church and everybody in it is fulfilling the purpose that God has for each and every one of them, that's when the church will be strong in this nation, and that's when the church will make a difference. So I want to kind of disarm this word purpose, but I also want you to understand it's a huge word. It's an important word, especially in Ignite Church. But here's what I want you to look at. When we think purpose, we think, what is my purpose? Why am I here? Am I here to be a missionary to Zimbabwe? To go into the tribe where they've never heard of Jesus? Maybe I'm here to heal cancer. Maybe that's my purpose. Maybe my purpose is to be the pastor of a mega church to reach thousands and thousands every Sunday. Maybe my purpose here, sometimes I think we can look at this word purpose and it's just overwhelming. It's just a huge word. We think, what is my purpose here? And we make it bigger. Just stick with me the whole message, okay? We make it bigger than what I think it really is. I want to challenge you this morning. You can put that graph up there. Don't look at the word purpose with a big capital P. You got that one? See, sometimes we look at the word purpose as a capital P, purpose. This morning, I want you to look at the word purpose as a lowercase p. And I'll explain that in a moment, okay? But we can look at this word purpose, and it's just so huge. It's so big. Don't look at the word purpose this morning with a capital P, small p, lowercase p. Think of it this way. It's not just one thing. What is my one thing? What is my capital P purpose in life? But look at it this way. What is my day after day, moment after moment, lowercase p purpose in this life? Think about it this way. I'm gonna clear that up. Some of you are like looking at me like, what the heck? Serving God's lowercase p purpose for that time, for that moment, and for that person. Right then. Let me give you an example. You're talking with somebody. You're talking with somebody who's depressed. You're talking with somebody who's disappointed. They're discouraged. They're stressed out. They're in need of help. Maybe they're sick. Maybe they're just hurting. Come on, we talk to those people every day. We run into those people every day. Listen, your lowercase purpose, my purpose right now in that moment is to be a voice of encouragement. It's to be a voice of hope. And my purpose in that very moment is like, wow, I can actually meet that need. I can actually meet that need. God has given me the ability to meet that need. God's lowercase purpose for me in that moment is to meet that need. It is that simple. God's lowercase purpose for me at that moment is to pray for my boss, to pray for my family member. God's lowercase p purpose for me is to feed that person. Is to buy that person some clothes. That's God's lowercase p purpose. God has a purpose, but sometimes we make it this big, huge thing. God wants to use me in a moment, in a time. And that's my purpose. That's your purpose. It's not always this big, huge, giant thing. What is God's purpose for you in the moment? In that situation? And now watch this. Can you guys give me a little bit of scripture freedom this morning? Okay. Just follow me. Don't say anything. Don't say anything bad. Don't retweet this. One day, when you're faithful in the little peas, God will reveal to you and trust you with the big P. Okay? No, that's not very spiritual, maybe, okay? Listen. When we are faithful with the little purposes that God gives us, those day-to-day, everyday moments in life, when we begin to be faithful with the lowercase p's in our life, and we just start stacking those up, God comes through and is faithful. And before you know it, you're sitting there and you're like, wow, That's my big B. That's my purpose. That's my purpose. But sometimes we're so overwhelmed with figuring out our capital P purpose in our life that we miss all the lowercase p purposes in our daily, every single day, moment-to-moment life. That's what God is looking for. That's what God wants. There's power in purpose, but it starts in this moment, in this time, with that person, with this person, with that coworker. That's our purpose. God wants to use each and every one of us to make a difference, but it starts with little p's, not big p's. Amen? Now, taking notes, here we go. Three thoughts today about the power. How many of you know there is power in purpose? There's power in purpose, and I'm going to prove that to you this morning. If you're taking notes, here's the first one. Purpose diminishes distractions. I'll explain these. You're kind of like, what? Purpose diminishes distractions. Follow me on this one. The biggest distraction you and I have, and I like that little commercial we have. The biggest distraction you and I have, whether you believe it or not, is comparison. I like that. If you caught what she was ordering for dinner, I'll have the approval of others. With a side of comparison, okay? That is our biggest distraction. Well, what do you think of me? What do you think of me? What will they say? Listen to me. Your friends. How can I word this? I'm thinking. They finished college in 3 years. You've been working on it for 8. You're comparing yourself. Man, they're making a 6-digit income. I'm still working part-time. Man, they're married already. I'm still single. Man, they've got 6 kids. I'm not even married. I'm not even dating anybody yet. We start comparing ourselves to others. Man, they already have a house. I'm still living with mom and dad. I'm still living in an apartment. Man, they've been promoted. They've been promoted 3 times, and I'm still working part-time. I can barely find a job. We start comparing ourselves. It goes on and on and on, just like that. Listen, comparison is the killer. It's the killer of the purpose. Purpose, watch this, demolishes all those distractions. Let me give you a quick example. I'm not going to have you turn to this. How many of you know the story of Nehemiah? If you don't know it, it's a great story. You'll find it in the Old Testament in the book of Nehemiah. He's got his own book, okay? Nehemiah was working for the king, not the king of Israel. He was working for the king, but he saw the city of Israel. He saw his city. The walls were broken down. The gates were destroyed. And the Bible tells us this. The Bible says that he was heartbroken over the condition of his city. He was heartbroken over the condition of his cities. The walls were broken down. The gates were destroyed. And let me take a quick time out. Let me mark my spot. Make sure. Listen. When something breaks your heart. When something breaks your heart, listen to me, it could very well be you found your purpose, okay? When something breaks, listen, somebody could walk right by something or somebody else. Somebody could walk right by something or somebody else that breaks your heart and it doesn't even faze them. There's nothing wrong with that person. In fact, too many times we have people doing things that God has not called them to do nor enabled them to do because that is not their purpose. But when something breaks your heart, listen to me, chances are you just found your purpose. Chances are you just found your purpose. Amen? That's free. That's free this morning, okay? That was totally free. So back to our story. So Nehemiah gets the king's permission, and he goes to work building this wall. And he's working hard, and he's making some progress. He's making some progress, and along come the enemies of God. Listen, whenever you're doing something for God, fulfilling your purpose, every single time the enemies of God will come, and they will come with distraction. They'll come with voices. They'll come with discouragement, and that's exactly what's going on here. Nehemiah is fulfilling God's purpose for his life. He's fulfilling God's plan, and they start mocking him. They try to discourage him. They try to distract him. They're yelling at him. And honestly, they said this. If a fox walks on that wall, it'll fall down. You'll never finish that wall. You're wasting your time. Come down from the wall. You're wasting your time. It's useless. It's useless. Come down from there. Come down there. Nehemiah was working away. All the while, these voices of discouragement, these voices of doubt, these distractions were coming at him loud and clear. They're just screaming at him. You know what he does? You know what he does? He just keeps placing one stone on top of the next one. One stone on top of the next one. But then he does finally answer his critics. And you know what he says? He basically says, I don't have time for that. I don't have time. That is the new TP version, okay? That's the Troy Perry version. And here's what Nehemiah actually said. He said, I am doing a great work, and I won't come down. I am doing a great work, and I'm not coming down. I am fulfilling God's purpose for this moment in my life, and I can't be distracted. I can't be distracted. I'm doing what God has created me for in this moment, and I'm not going to be distracted. I'm not going to listen to your voice. I'm not coming down from that wall. I'm going to do what God has called me to do, and your voice, your distraction, is not going to deter me because of the purpose that is in my life. The purpose that is in my life is going to push me through all the distractions, through every one of them. He's working away. He's working away all these voices, but he just keeps piling up stones. He's like, I don't have time for that. The voices are going to come, and they're going to distract you. You can jot this down. I may have even given you it. Nehemiah 6:3. I'm doing a great work. I don't know if that translation says, I'm doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave it and go down to you? Listen, just real quick. It may not seem very, what you're doing, the capital P, the little P thing, it may not seem very important to you right now. It may not seem that big. It may not seem big to anybody, not even you. I don't think Nehemiah even, I know the people around Nehemiah thought, you're just wasting your time. I don't even know that Nehemiah caught the very significance in what he was doing. I don't think Nehemiah even knew how important it was what he was doing. But he was doing what God told him to do. He was just obeying. But I don't know that he understood the importance. Listen, whatever you might be doing, the lowercase p's purposes in your life, they may not seem very important. They may not seem very important to you or to the people around you, but they're important to God. And you just keep doing. Nehemiah just kept doing it. He just kept stacking up blocks. Whatever it is. I went to a conference. I shouldn't always say the things that come into my head. Go to a lot of pastor things, a lot of conferences, different conferences. And I'm telling you, whenever I'm sitting down in that kind of environment, and pastors are awesome, incredible people, please do not take this wrong. Usually within a 5-minute conversation with a pastor, I always get, someone already said, I always get this question. Within 5 minutes, nonstop, never fails, I always get this question. So, how big's your church? I wanted to tell one guy one time, I wanted to say, 8,635 square foot, because I knew that's not what he's looking for, okay? But I always get that question. Not one time have I ever been asked, so, are you fulfilling God's purpose for your life? Because really, which of those two is more important? How big is your church? Or are you fulfilling God's purpose for your life? And listen, sometimes it doesn't seem very big. Sometimes it doesn't, come on, look around you. Sometimes it doesn't seem very big. But you know what I'm doing? Man, I'm just stacking up lowercase p's, stacking up lowercase p's, stacking up lowercase p's until finally I'm going to fill God's capital P purpose for what he's called us to do. Listen, you're here this morning. Man, maybe you're a student. Maybe you're going to college. Maybe you're here this morning. You're trying to get that college degree, and it's taking you longer than it should have. It's taking you longer than you wanted it to. It's actually taking you longer than it should have, and you're hearing the voices of distraction. You're hearing the voices of, you'll never finish. You're not smart enough. Come on, man. All your friends are already got the degree and then some, right? You need to repeat that verse. No. I'm doing a great work. I'm doing a great work, and you're not going to distract me, and I'm not going to stop. I'm not coming down. Listen, man, how many of you, don't even raise your hand. You're trying to get out of debt. You're trying to get out of debt. That's huge. That's a big thing. But listen, when you try to get out of debt, the enemy's going to come against you, and it's going to be distractions. It's going to be like, you'll never get out of debt. Then you pay off that bill, you'll just have 4 more others. Quit brown bagging it to work every day. Listen, eat, drink, and be merry. Come on, man. You're never going to get out of debt anyway. No, listen, I'm doing a great work, and I am not coming down from that. Young people, single people in here this morning, staying pure. Listen, out in our world today, if you're trying to stay pure, you know what the world's going to tell you? That is like so 50s, man. That is like old time. What are you doing? Come on, everybody's doing it. You need to just enjoy life. You need to just get out there. No. I'm doing a great work, and I am not coming down. Listen, you're coming to church every single Sunday. What's the purpose? You're building your inner man. You are building your inner man. And if somebody says, what? You're wasting your time. No. I'm doing a great work. And I'm not coming down. You're inviting. Come on. How many of you invited people to church and they haven't come yet? Always throw that yet in there, right? Other people say, man, you just keep inviting them and they don't even come. You're wasting your time. No. I'm doing a great work. And I am not coming down. Listen, whatever it is that you're going through, whatever the distraction may be, there's power and purpose over those distractions. Amen. I'm doing a great work and I'm not coming down. And my purpose in life is going to push me past all the distractions, all of those things. Amen. So that's the first one. Second one, here we go. Purpose pushes you through the pain. How many of you know there's going to be pain in fulfilling the purpose God has for your life? There's going to be pain. How many of you, just out of curiosity, how many of you have John 16:33 on your refrigerator at home? How many of you have like John 16:33? Yeah, that's my life verse. How many of you right now are thinking, what the heck is John 16:33? John 16:33, nobody's life verse in this place. In this life, you will have troubles. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I just claimed that verse. That is my life verse. No. But it's the biblical. In this life, you will have trouble. But your purpose will push you through the pain. It'll push you through the pain. Listen to me. All through the Bible, Moses, David, Esther. Oh, I wrote a list, but I could give you just about any name. Mary, Peter, Paul, the disciples, Jesus had to go through pain to fulfill the purpose. Whenever you're doing the will of God, the enemy's going to come and he's going to bring resistance. There's going to be pain. There's going to be trouble. But there's a purpose. There's a purpose. You'll be misunderstood. All of those things. Recognize that and let the purpose of your calling, the purpose of God in your life, push you through the pain of that. Amen? Listen, I got a simple illustration for that. I got a really simple one. It's called childbirth. We have 9 children. And let me tell you, that's a painful process, okay? I know. I've been through it 9 times. All the women out there are like shaking their head like, you don't even know. Yeah, I do. I was there 9 times. I was there all 9 times. I was there. It was painful, okay? It was painful. Yeah, right, Troy. Listen, let me tell you something about us. I'm a really tough guy. Okay, I just take a licking and keep on ticking, okay? I ride dirt bikes, I fall off, get back up, play a lot of football, basketball, get ran over, knocked down. I'm tough in that way, man. I just get beat up, knocked around. I just get up and keep on going. Nowadays, I get up a little slower, and it hurts the next day, but I'm still built that way. I'm just tough. Now, I love my wife. She's awesome. She's incredible. Let me say this with all due respect. She is a bit of a wimp. Sorry, honey. I'll get some good stuff in just a moment, okay? She's a bit of a wimp when it comes to that. Oh, my toe hurt again. Listen, now follow me on this, okay? If it was left to me, Tim, you'd be an only child, okay? Tim is my oldest, okay? He would be an only child. Because I've been there, and I'd seen this, and I'd be like, we're not doing this again. If I had to birth that kid, if I had to birth any of these 9 kids, we'd have one kid. We would have one kid. I don't care how tough I am, okay? It'd be like, no, we are not doing that again, okay? We are not doing that again. But this wimpy, beautiful gal did it 9 times. Check this out. It's not, 8 of them, all natural. Only one had an epidural and some drugs. Man, if it was me, there is nothing natural about doing that without drugs, okay? That is not natural. That is unnatural, okay? Man, I'd be like, give me the drugs. Listen, why could somebody do that? How could somebody do that? Listen to me. It was the purpose of that pregnancy that got her through the pain. Amen? It was the purpose behind it. It was the purpose that caused her to do it again and 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 again. Why? That, I'm telling you, if there's anybody in here and you're pregnant and it's your first one, I'm really sorry. Okay? You don't have a lot to look forward to. It's painful. Why did she keep doing it? Why did she keep doing it? Oh, the purpose. The purpose pushed her through the pain. You'll get through that pain when you realize the purpose. Listen, the cross, Jesus went to the cross. The purpose of the cross was to reestablish us with our God. You don't think the cross was painful? Yes, Jesus was God, but Jesus was all man. He felt every bit of that cross. But he endured the cross. He endured the pain because of the purpose. Because of the purpose. Your life, my life, it is the same thing. You can endure the pain when you know the purpose. When you know your purpose. Listen, every now and again, it's going to get painful. People are going to hurt you. Listen to me. People are going to hurt you. They're going to mistreat you. They're going to criticize you. They're going to leave you. They're going to desert you. And all of that's only if you're a pastor, okay? It gets even worse than that, okay? Listen, you're going to get hurt. You're going to get hurt. There's going to get pain. But knowing your purpose will push you through that pain. I was purposed for this. This is what God created me to do. This is what God calls me to do. Yeah, I can't please everyone, which is going to lead us into our last point. I can't please everyone, but if I know my purpose, it'll push me through the pain. Last one. Purpose empowers us to please God. Purpose, man, when you know your purpose, man, that's like what energizes you. That's what empowers you to please God. I think, I'm looking at my notes, I think Moses kind of tapped into that. How many of you know Moses faced all kinds of opposition on both sides? There was a point in time where the Israelites didn't like him. And I know Pharaoh didn't think very highly of him. I know he wasn't pleasing Pharaoh. I know he wasn't pleasing the Israelites. There was a time in his life when he was like just stuck in the middle, getting beat up on both sides. But he knew his purpose. He knew his purpose. He knew his purpose wasn't to please the Israelites. His purpose was not to please Pharaoh. He knew his purpose was to please God. And when you get a hold of that, when you know that that is your purpose, it empowers you. It empowers you to keep going. And it said in Hebrews, you don't have to go to that scripture because we're going to a different one. Looking ahead. He knew. He was looking ahead. Man, I don't care about this person or that person pleasing them right now. I'm looking ahead because I want to make sure that I please my God and fulfill the purpose for which he put me in here. Acts chapter 5, verse 27. Watch this. You can turn there real quick. It should be up on the screen. Acts chapter 5, verse 27, it says this. The apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. This was they were talking to them right now. They say this. We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name. He said, yet you have, let me back up. We have given you strict orders not to teach in this name. What name is that? The name of Jesus. Isn't it crazy? I see that verse and it just like, it hasn't changed much, has it? It has not changed at all. I could probably go into a school. I could probably go into the city hall. I could probably go into Congress. I could probably go just about anywhere and preach about a higher power, right? I could probably go anywhere and preach about a supreme being. I could maybe get away with going somewhere and preaching about a God, right? But if I go into any of those places and preach the name of Jesus, all hell, literally, all hell will break loose, amen? All hell, why? We talked about this a couple weeks ago. The name of Jesus is greater than any name. We talked about this a couple weeks. There's cancer is a powerful name, depression, debt, we talked about all of those. But how many of you know the name of Jesus is greater than the name of cancer? The name of Jesus is greater than all names. And it's funny that 2,000 years ago, they were trying to get them to stop talking about the name of Jesus, to stop preaching in the name of Jesus. And today they're doing the very same thing. Why? Because the enemy knows when we get hold of the fact that the name of Jesus is more greater, it's more powerful than any other thing, we're going to be victorious on this earth. We're going to be victorious. Again, that was all free. Let's read on, okay? We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name. I'll read it up there. He said, yet you have filled, I love it, you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood, Jesus. Peter and the other disciples replied, we must obey God, what? Rather than human beings. Can I paraphrase it for you? We must please who? God rather than man. We got to please God rather than man. Rather than men. Their response was so key. They got a hold of this. They're like, man, we're not out for the approval of people. We're not doing this for the approval of man. We're doing what we do to please God. To please God. And listen, when that's your motive, when you get a hold of that, That purpose will push you. It'll empower you. It'll empower you to do and to fulfill what God has called you to do. Listen, I didn't know how to write this in my notes, so I'm just going to say it, okay? It is pathetic, okay? It is pathetic the way we seek after the approval of men. It is just pathetic. We're so consumed with, do you like me? Am I okay? Do you approve of me? Is everything, listen, I'm a Christian. Did you know I'm a Christian? Is that okay with you? Am I too spiritual for you? Am I not? Listen, how many of you know, anybody out there go see that movie, I'm Not Ashamed? Don't worry, we were the only two in the theater too when we saw it, okay? So, we really were, okay? Great movie. It's a movie about the Columbine shooting. I can actually highly recommend a movie in church. Yeah, okay. Great movie. It was about the girl. It talked about, it pretty much was her life story out of, can I just share something? Yeah, I think I can. My daughter, I can even use her name. Please don't tell her. I'll have to give her $5, okay? Micah actually invited two or three of her friends to go with her to the movies to see this movie. And this movie is about a gal, a Christian gal, who actually dies in the Columbine shooting. And the movie's taken strictly from her journal. And it talks about this very thing. A girl that struggled most of her life figuring out what God had her there for. She just knew that there was a purpose in her life. But maybe a year or two before she was killed, I'm not trying to ruin the movie for you. You can read the book and that'll ruin it for you. She figured out her purpose. She figured out her purpose. And the pain, everything she went through, it didn't even slow her down. It caused her not to even hesitate. Her purpose, once she knew her purpose, the distractions in high school and all of that, man, they were gone. It cut right through all of that kind of stuff. It's a really good movie. I don't know how I got stuck on that, but go see it if you'd like to. Listen, next slide, and we're closing. We can't please everyone, but we can please God. Say that with me in the first person. Say, I. I can't please everyone, but I can please God. Listen to me this morning. You can't please everyone. You can't please everyone, but you can please God. Why are we wasting so much stinking time trying to please everybody else when we never will, and so little time trying to please God? We've got it backwards. We please God when we live by faith. We please God when we're obedient to the lowercase p, the lowercase purposes in our lives. We please God when we die to ourselves. We know we can't please everyone, so let's just focus on pleasing God. Amen? Let's stop being so consumed with pleasing other people, especially when it just deters us from the purpose and plan of God in our life. Amen? Come on, there's power in purpose, even in the lowercase p purposes. Hebrews 11:26, it said it was of greater value. Listen, I'm not going to stand up here and tell you, oh, you don't need people to like you. No. There's value in people liking you, okay? There's value in people in being liked by people. But watch this, there's greater value. That's what Moses found. There's greater value when your purpose overcomes the distraction. There's greater value when your purpose pushes you through the pain. There's greater value when your purpose empowers you to please God. That's where the greater value is at. God has placed you here for a purpose and a reason. Don't be so overwhelmed with that P, purpose, capital P. Live for the purpose every day, every moment. I was closing my notes out and I was thinking about this. You're here for a reason. You have a purpose. It may not even seem that big or that important to you. Can I tell you this? It's huge for God. We looked at Hebrews chapter 11. It's actually called the heroes of faith in the Bible. By faith, Abraham. By faith, Noah. By faith, Moses. Can I give you another one out of there? By faith, Rahab. 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 Yeah, Rahab. Can I just put it in modern day terms? The prostitute. Rahab. Listed in the heroes of faith. Her purpose? What'd she do? Did she lead a revival? Did she lead an army? What did she do? You want to know what she did? She let two spies into her house and hid them overnight. And she's listed in the Heroes of Faith. That's a lowercase p if I've ever seen one, right? That's it. I don't think she understood the importance at that moment of what she was doing. And I want to encourage you, your day-to-day life, your moment-by-moment life, when you start fulfilling the lowercase p purposes in your life, those are huge to God. You may not see them. Others may not see them. But they're huge to God. Who you are today is a result of the choices you've made. I said that I would encourage you. Who you will be, who you can be, and who you want to be will be a result of the choices you make from today and now on. Watch this. I'm closing with this, I promise. So if day after day you'll choose purpose over popularity, if you'll continue to be faithful in the little piece, he'll be faithful in the big one. Follow me. If you'll just keep stacking them up, and if you will just keep stacking up those lowercase p purposes of God, if you'll just keep stacking those up, listen to me, if you'll just keep stacking them up, you know what you're going to do? Number one, you're going to please God. Number two, you're going to be pleased with who you've become. Amen? Come on, isn't that what we're looking for? To please God? And I want to be pleased with where I'm going, with what I'm doing. Listen, every single one of you have a purpose. God's got a purpose and a plan for your life. There's no mistake that you're even in this church. There's no mistake that you're in the workplace that you're in. God has a purpose and a plan for your life. Keep your eyes open for that capital P purpose, but start looking for the everyday, moment by moment, lowercase p purposes in your life. And just fill those. Begin to fulfill those and stack them up. And watch what God does. Watch what God does. Amen. I want to pray for you. Then we'll have prayer and Tim will come on up. Father, I thank you for those that are here this morning, God. And I thank you for Ignite Church, God. We are a church that believes in the purpose of people. That people have a purpose. That you've placed each and every one of them on this earth for a purpose, for a time. For such a time as this, God. And I pray this morning that we would begin to realize. We'd begin to recognize and see our purpose, our call, our destiny, God. That we would begin to see everyday purposes, lowercase p's, that you give us opportunities, God. And we will walk in them. We will begin to fulfill those. We'll just continue to stack up lowercase p's, God. We're going to be faithful in the little p's so that we can see the big P, the capital P purpose in our life fulfilled, God. I thank you for those that are here this morning, God. Now let us begin to see day by day, moment by moment, your purpose for our lives, your purpose for us being where we're at every single day, Lord, every single day. In Jesus' name.